Today we begin the subject, the CW complexes. In this chapter, we shall first introduce the most important class of topological spaces for algebraic topology, namely CW complexes. We shall study some fundamental points and topological properties of these spaces related to the simplicial complexes that you have studied in part 1. And also in subsequent chapters, we shall study its relation with fundamental groups and various other things also, homology and so on, as and when time permits. CW complexes are built up out of from nowhere perhaps. So by a sequence of operations called attaching cells. The attaching cells itself was studied in part 1, but I will recall it so that to refresh your memory. So fix an integer k and an indexing set lambda. For each index lambda, choose a copy of the unit disk in Rn, Rk. So all these copies are supposed to be disjoint now. They are copies of the same disk Dk. Okay. Now suppose X and Y are topological spaces. We say X is obtained from Y by attaching K cells from this indexing set, if there exists, okay, so given two topological spaces X and Y, we say X is obtained by attaching a K cell to Y, if there exists a family of functions F alpha from the boundary of the disk, which is SK minus 1, the sphere, to Y. For each alpha, you must have such a function, such that X is the quotient space of the disjoint union of Y and all the copies of the disk DK by the relation X is equivalent to F alpha X whenever X is in the boundary of DK of alpha. Remember, boundary of DK of alpha is SK minus 1, and then there is a map F alpha. This is a quotient space. Let us denote the quotient map itself by Q. And then remember what is the meaning of the quotient space, the topology on X. What is it? A subset of X is open if and only if its inverse image under Q is open in the disjoint union of these things. The disjoint union of these spaces is given the disjoint topology. So you have to remember that. The maps F alpha are called attaching maps for the cell. Okay. Let us restrict the quotient map Q here to each DK, the DK of alpha, and then let us call them as phi alpha. These phi alphas are called characteristic maps of the cell. They are homeomorphisms in the interior of DK, and they are equal to F alpha on the boundary. Okay. The image of DK of alpha is a compact subspace of X because DK of alpha are compact and F alpha, three alphas are continuous. So we call them closed K cells in this pair XY. Notice that why I am writing this XY is Y is given space and X is obtained by this operation. Okay. the image of all these dk of alpha under phi alpha will be denoted by corresponding ek of alpha, and they are called closed cases. So y is an injective map on Q. There is no identification within y. Therefore, we can use to the simplify the notation. We can use the same y for the image of QI, image under QI. For any subset A of Y, QA can be identified with A, and it's a closed subset in QI, because if you QA is closed in QI, if and only if QA is closed in X. Okay, that is the definition. But QI, if A is closed in Y as such, its inverse image will be closed inside Y again, because under Q it is just A itself. And in all other dk of alphas, it is F alpha inverse of this A. A being closest, F alpha has been continuous, they will be closed subsets of SK minus 1. Therefore, they will be closed subsets of dk also. Okay. So, with this identification, it is not just a set theoretic identification, it is a topological identification. All right. So, to reduce the number of notations and so on, we can now think of Y as a subspace of X, and that is why we can use this notation XY. This is usually notation for whenever A comma B is used, B is a subspace of A. So that is the standard notation for pairs of topological spaces. So here is a basic lemma out of this quotient space topology. All these things are consequences of just taking the quotient space topology on the disjoint union of Y and dk of alphas. Okay, so first one is, each ek is a closed subset of X. Okay, so that is where we have to assume that Y is a Hausdorff space. Ek of alpha being an image of a compact set, it's a compact subset. Okay, the boundary of ek of alpha is subset of Y, and that will be closed. So we have to see that that will help to see that ek of alpha itself is closed in X. Okay, each characteristic map is itself a quotient map. A subset A of X is closed in X if and only if A intersection Y is closed in Y and A intersection ek of alpha is closed in ek of alpha. So this characterization C is now exactly copy of the characterization of the quotient topology here. Here, the characterization is in the top space here, on the mother space. Whereas this part C here transfers the whole thing inside the quotient space X itself. You don't have to go above. Okay, it is same thing, but you have to prove this one. So what is the proof? Proof is using again and again the Hausdorffness and this quotient map. How perform? I mean, what is the definition of a open subset in X or a closed subset in X? So first of all, Y is Hausdorff, SK minus 1 is compact. For each alpha, F alpha of SK minus 1, which we denote by EK dot, DK dot denoting the boundary of EK of alpha. Okay, all the interior points are taken away from this cell. This is a closed subset of it. Now, fix a beta, okay? To see that EK beta is closed, for every beta you want to say this is a closed subset, right? This is a claim. So all that you have to do is go back and check the criteria. Q inverse of EK beta must be closed in the disjoint union. In Y, what is it? Portion of Y, it is just Q inverse of the part which comes from the boundary part. Okay, Q inverse of EK beta intersection Y is nothing but EK beta dot. And this is closed. Q inverse of EK beta inside DK beta, it is identity map here, this is just DK beta. Q inverse of EK beta, beta not equal to alpha, What is it? It is just the boundary in F inverse of the boundary. Okay. Since this is closed, and this is obviously dk beta is closed in dk beta. Okay. So this proves A. Once A is proved, now the criteria for Ek of alpha being closed. A contain Ek of alpha is such that phi inverse of A, sorry, this is now what we are proving. We are proving that the quotient map restricted to each characteristic map, each dk of alpha, each cell that is closed, right? That is a quotient map. So take a subset of Ek of alpha such that its inverse image under phi alpha, which is same thing as q alpha inverse, but inside dk of alpha, only one alpha is taken. P alpha, that is phi alpha. Phi alpha inverse of A is closed in dk. Suppose this is true. To show that A is closed in dk of alpha, you have to verify that in all the full inverse image, Q inverse image, it is a closed subset. That's what you have to show. Okay. To show that A is closed in dk of alpha, same thing as saying that it's closed in X. Why? Because dk of alpha itself is closed. So once again, to show that means Q inverse of A itself is closed in here. Okay. By the hypothesis, F alpha inverse of A is closed in SK of alpha. Because you have started with A inside this one, this is closed. Intersects with the boundary, it will be closed in there. Hence, A intersection boundary is EK of alpha, that's closed. So once you have this, this first one here, the other two will follow just the same way here. Okay. Now, once you have A and B, C is now direct consequence of B because Q is a quotient topology. What is the definition of C? C says subset of X is closed if and only A intersection Y is closed in Y, and A intersection EK of, if it's closed, these things are closed because they are subspaces. Converse is what you have to see. Suppose A intersection Y is closed, then that is Q inverse of A intersection Y, right? So well, that part is fine. A intersection Ek of alpha is closed, then by Q, the phi alpha inverse, A, Q inverse of A intersection dk of alpha should be closed because this is a quotient map. So that will complete the proof of that A itself is a closed subset. In the definition of the attaching, we could have taken the indexing set to be empty also, just for logical reasons. And we should include this one. It should not disturb it. Should not assume that lambda is non-empty. Of course, what you get is Y itself. When you don't attach anything, okay, then X will be Y itself. That's all. The family could have been empty. If a family has just one member, okay, then this is nothing but X is nothing but the mapping cone of F. F from SK minus 1 to Y is a function. And then you are filling up this SK minus 1 with the cell, with the DK, which is the same thing as taking the cone over that part. Okay. So this will would have been, if you know, I mean, we have to do, know the map, what is the definition of mapping cone here, because I am not recalling that here. So that is a special case, and in that special case we have this simple notation also, Y union over F of the cell EK. It's only one cell, there is no need for writing alpha. In general, without the assumption of Hausdorffness, EK of alpha may not be closed. Very simple examples can be given, there is no problem about that. Okay. However, even if you don't assume Y is Hausdorff or anything, Y will be always a closed subset of X in the attaching process. Also, unless on the boundary, namely F alpha's attaching maps are 1-1, you will not have EK of alpha homeomorphic to DK. Okay. So here in the figure I have given you an example of attaching one cells only. K equal to 1 in this picture. The pictures can be always 1 or 2 dimension anyway. So This is your y, which looks like y anyway. And the first cell is attached to one cell. One cell is from d1. D1 is minus 1 plus 1, the interval minus 1 plus 1. Okay. So minus 1 has gone here, plus 1 has gone here. F of minus 1 is this point and it is identified. F of minus 1 plus 1 is this point is identified here. That's the meaning of this identification space. This could be just anything homeomorphic to open interval here. Similarly, this is another open interval here, another cell. Remember the interior of this cell, interior of this cell, interior of this cell, they are all disjoint. On the boundary, what happens? That is left to f alphas. Our boundary should be always on, has mapped onto y, somewhere inside y. In this d1, d1-3, the third cell, both the points of the boundary have gone to a single point. So corresponding to this f3 is a one-point map. So now you see that this is not homeomorphic to d1 at all. These things are homeomorphic to these two, but this is not. Okay, so this is what happens. If you draw a picture, suppose I draw a line like this, that is not considered, that cannot be a attaching map. It is a, you know, that is not part of attachment. On the other hand, I can just take a point here, just a point here. That is allowed. Then it will be attaching a zero cell. Okay, it's not attaching one cell. So just now we have defined k equal to a constant and k greater than equal to 1. So let me define what is the meaning of attaching a zero cell also. All right. So we say x is obtained by attaching a zero cell. I defined k greater than equal to 1 here, k cells, right? So I want to include zero cell also. What is the meaning of attaching a zero cell? Namely, x is disjoint union of y and z, where z is a closed discrete subspace of x. Discrete and closed subspace of x. Y itself will be closed. Both y and z will be closed by this definition because it's a disjoint union of two topological spaces. A y is a given space, z is a set of points. The topology on those points is just discrete. This is completely justified because first of all, you have to say what the meaning of zero cell or D0. Okay, D0, zero cell, R0, what is it? It's a zero vector space. So there is only one vector there, which is a zero vector. So a zero cell is just a singleton. Okay, it loses all the other geometric properties here. It's a singleton. And then what is its boundary? Boundary is empty. So there is no map there. Therefore, no gluing takes place. So this is the logical justification for defining like this. If you have difficulties in this logic, you can just take this as definition, no problem. Okay. Attaching element that belongs to Z is then a zero cell of X. These are elements of Z are called zero cells. Point Y is a black box. There is no, this is like a base space. There is no name for this one. When you attach a zero cell, they come from a disjoint set. Attach one set, they come from a disjoint set indexed by a family. Okay, that's what it is. A zero cell, by the very definition, by the topology and whatever you want to say, each point in Z is closed as well as open in the whole space. Its zero cell is both an open cell as well as a closed cell. The quotient topology retains a number of properties of the base space, of the top space. There are quite a few of them, like Hausdorffness. They don't go to the quotient space. You have studied quotient space thoroughly last time. Okay. So what happens is, away from Y, you can expect a few properties of the Euclidean space inside X. I mean, X minus Y can have a number of topological properties inherent from the quotient space, from the Euclidean spaces, because dk have been attached there. Okay, the first attempt is here is, so what kind of things may happen inside dn and sn minus 1? That is an elementary thing here. So I have put it as a lemma, which is the starting point of our topology here. Take a subset A contained as sn minus 1. Okay, fix an epsilon between 0 and 1, strictly between 0 and 1. Let us put n epsilon A, this is notation, all x in dn, such that norm x is bigger than epsilon, and when you divide by a modulus, namely the unit vector is inside A. Remember, A is inside sn minus 1, so it has to be unit vector. Okay, take all such elements as this x by norm x varies over A. What are these things? This is just like take a vector V and multiply it by some number r between 0 and 1. Okay, so I can say it like that also. So point and then a small line segment going towards 0. But 0 is strictly avoided because this 0 is less than epsilon less than 1. Okay, all those points you take. All right. Then this n epsilon A, okay, see x, this norm x is bigger than epsilon, it will include 1 also, only the epsilon is between 0 and 1, this norm x can be 1, norm x will never be 0 because norm x is bigger than epsilon, that's all. So n epsilon A intersection sn minus 1 will be exactly A for all points. Take A, say V belong to A, that V itself will be there. Okay. So A is contained here, this one is clear, but intersection Sn minus 1 is precisely A because norm has to be 1. The norm has to be 1, this is precisely equal to that point. N epsilon A is an open subset of A, if you know if A is open in Sn minus 1. So this is also clear. If this is an open subset, intersection is open subset is clear. If A is open, why this one is open? Because this will be like, just like then, an open arc, you know, it's like a product topology now, cross with 1 minus epsilon to 1, 1 minus epsilon open, that will be the topology of this one. That's why this is N epsilon A is open. The last thing which is very important is that you look at this map which joins x and x by norm x, the line segment, 1 minus t times x plus t times 1 minus x, t times x by norm x. Okay, if t is 0, this is x, if t is 1, it is x by norm x. This is strong deformity tract of n epsilon onto A. There is a picture. If you allowed epsilon to be 0 also, then there is no deformation because you don't know where to send the 0. 0 has to be not there. Okay, that's important. To avoid 0, then you have this. These are called, you can call it a collar neighborhood of A inside Dn. Okay, so from this one, now we want to extend this one to the attaching cells from Y to X. Okay, so what we do? We take a family of decays alpha and suppose I have attached them to Y, just like in the definition above. Now start with a subset B of Y, okay? And then look at, for each alpha, look at F alpha inverse of B. That is a subset of SK minus 1, the boundary of DK, right? So treat this as A, choose enough some epsilon, call it as epsilon alpha, take n of that, n epsilon of that. So you have chosen these open subsets, let us say if this is open, then that is open, otherwise it is not open, it's an open collar. Inside dk of alpha, for each alpha, take the union, that's a disjoint union, include B also, take the image Q under Q, Q of that. So call that as N epsilon B. Okay, so N epsilon A in the earlier thing was defined only for this picture. Now I have defined this for when X is obtained by obtained from Y by attaching cells. Okay, the first thing is to take N epsilon B intersect Y points which are inside Y of this one. They are nothing but QB. Okay. If Q of, if you take this part, they will also coincide inside Y, so they will be just QB. N epsilon B is open if and only if B is open in Y. So it's a straightforward from previous lemma. If B is open in Y, each of this is open, so then N epsilon is open. These are the intersections of N epsilon B inside DK alpha, and this part is B. This is part of Y, so that follows from directly from previous lemma and quotient topology definition. B, which is equal to QB, you can write it as B or QB because we have identified these things, they are subsets of Y. It's a strong deformation type of N epsilon B. So this follows from the third statement here, put together. So how do you do that? All that you have to do is on each alpha, H alpha, take this map. For each H alpha, take this map. Okay. Put them together in the disjoint union. What you get is H restricted to B cross I, put it as identity. And in the rest of these things, put this as H alpha. Okay. So this patches up to define a big homotopy from this entire space to this space. Q of that of cross I have taken, Q of that cross I identity, you'll come back to H hat. Okay, so this will give you a homotopy from N epsilon B cross I to N epsilon B. Homotopy of the identity map with the with the retraction there. Okay, on to B. Everything will go inside B there. Okay, so this property we are going to use it again and again. So you can recall that this notation T3 space means what? A Hausdorff space T2 plus regular. Similarly, T4 means a Hausdorff space which is normal. Okay, now this is a simple exercise. Maybe it should take some time, like you have to verify case by case and so on. But this is an exercise which you should be able to do by yourself. Do it so that you get familiar with what is going on with this lemma. Okay, now let me give you the definition of CW complex. A relative CW complex will define slightly more general things, just like attaching maps from Y to X, right? By the way, one of the things is that Y could have been empty set also. Okay, can it be? If Y is empty set, K is greater than or equal to 1, what are the maps? There's no map. So you will never get to attach any one cells, but you can attach zero cells. Okay, so Y is empty is allowed if you can attach zero cells. Okay, and that is why we want to take empty family as well as empty set as permitted. Okay, so let us take this relative CW complex. What is the definition? A is a space, some topological space, and X is obtained by a sequence of processes, namely each process is an attaching K cell where K equal to 0, 1, 2, 3 and so on. So let me make an elaborate definition here. Consists of a topological space X and a closed subspace A, which is Hausdorff. This is a part of the definition. Some people don't assume it, but I am going to assume this. Okay, together with a sequence of closed subspaces, Xn, n greater than or equal to 0. So I'm going to define X0, X1, X2, X3, okay, inductively. So what is X0 going to do? A is a subset of X0, and X0 minus A is a discrete space. It's precisely what is the meaning of, we have already defined, that X0 is obtained by A by attaching zero cells. So instead of saying that, I have just said X0 minus A is a discrete space. Okay, A is a closed subset. Xk is obtained by attaching k cells to Xk minus 1 for all k greater than or equal to 1. Okay, so X1, what is X1? It's attaching one cells to Xk minus 1, which is X0. Okay, X0 could have been just A, because all that you need is A is contained as X0. This is a discrete space. If it's empty set, it's also allowed. Okay, so do this for each K. Then what is X? X is just the union of all these spaces. Remember, by the very definition here, Xk will be a subset of Xk plus 1 and so on. Each of them closed in the next one. So you have sequence of closed sections. A contained is X0, contained is X1, and so on. Take the union. That is your X. The last thing is, what is the topology on X? This topology is called the weak topology, or what is known as the coherent topology or co-induced topology. All that names are of no use unless you know what is the meaning. So meaning is precisely a subset of X is closed if and only if its intersection with each Xk is closed inside Xk. Xk is the space is here with being obtained from Xk minus 1 and so on by attaching K cells. Okay. So the topology on each Xk is well defined as soon as you know what is A and you know what are the attaching maps. There is no ambiguity. But what is the topology on this infinite union? That has to be defined, and this point 4 here takes care of that. It says it's a coherent topology, coherent with respect to each Xk. Okay, automatically, with this definition, each Xk will be a closed subset of the whole space X. Not only Xk is closed inside Xk plus 1, it will be closed inside Xk also. So all these things we can see, but this is the definition first of all. Okay, the interesting case I told you, A could have been empty. Then X0 minus A cannot be empty. Cannot be means what? If it is empty, then everything else will be empty. Because X1 have to be attached, you know, one cells, one to attach one cells, you need maps. Maps into empty set, there are no maps, empty. Okay, so then everything will be empty. But X0 may not be empty, there may be one point at least. 2 points, 50,000 points, no problem. Okay, it's a discrete space. Then you can start attaching more and more. But in between, you may not attach, for example, one cells at all. You may not attach two cells at all. You may directly attach three cells. That's possible. In between, some Xk may be equal to Xk minus 1. Okay, so all these things are allowed. So one of the interesting cases when A is empty, then we don't write X, comma A at all, we just write X. And that is called a CW complex. So I will redefine what a CW complex. A CW complex, if it's non-empty, it has to start with some discrete set, X naught. It has to. Otherwise, it's empty. Okay. So there will be a set of points. You can call them as vertices, just like in the case of simplicial complex. So these x naught, you can call them as zero cells or vertices also, no problem. So it is a discrete space. Then it is a question of, I mean, what you want to do, what the space is. There may not be one cell, there may be one cell, there may be 50,000 two cells and so on. The only thing that is needed is, if you take a K cell, the attaching map to that K cell, which is on the boundary of this K cell, namely SK minus 1, that has to be a map from SK minus 1 into the XK minus 1. So these XKs are called the Kth skeleton of X. It is just a name, okay, and a useful name. So that's what. It may happen that after a certain stage, there are no K cells. No cells have been attached. So X is stopped at XK. If that happens, we call this X K dimensional, less than root K dimensional. Suppose there are at least one, there is at least one K cell, and no more cells of dimension bigger than that, then we call dimension of X equal to K. Okay, so these are just definitions. So open cells, characteristic maps, attaching maps, all these things make sense in the case of CW complex also, relative CW complex also. Whatever you have done for attaching maps, okay? So that is just the gist of the definition. We shall take up this study next time. Thank you.